with Prasanth, organizer API Craft Bengaluru, and he will be talking about the topic Account Aggregation and the India Stack, Democratizing Customer Data. So Prasanth is joining us. Hi, Prasanth.
Hi, Dheeraj. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Very warm welcome to you. And you can also start sharing your screen as well.
Is it visible to you?
Yes, now we can see. Great. So stage is all yours, and we will take any questions which you might have at the end of your session.
Thanks, Dheeraj. Hi, everybody. The session I am going to do is on account aggregation and the India Stack, democratizing the customer data. We'll start with a definition of what India Stack is. You all might have heard about Aadhaar, the unique digital identity platform, the digital identity methodology, which was brought in India and which has reached out to over a billion people. India has provided a unique ID cards for the citizens of the country. It forms just one part of the what we call as India Stack. India Stack essentially comprises of a set of digital public good infrastructure, as we call it, driven by the government or government agencies in association with the private entities, and which focuses on unbundling or digitizing the identity, the signature, the authorization, the financial sector, and the document and data exchange. All these are being done from the perspective of letting the organizations, individuals take advantage of it and build unique apps, solutions, innovative solutions on top of it. It essentially comprises of four technology layers, broadly classified like presenceless layer, paperless layer, cashless layer, and consent layer. So the presenceless layer enables an individual with a unique identity card called Aadhaar to avail a plethora of services without being physically present at the time of availing the service. Paperless layer enables the movement of your person's digital records with his or her consent, and which are stored in a government-enabled DigiLocker. Cashless layer, India is a land of, you know, diversity, and it has its own unique challenges. And we have been, we are still a predominantly cash-driven economy. And like we say, you have to look for an opportunity in terms of adversity. One of the opportunities or one of the positive things that came out of this COVID-19 related lockdowns are that we have furthermore moved towards a cashless economy. And then a consent layer, which with the help or with the consent of the individual or the organization, helps it to provide his or her or the entity's financial data in order to avail value-added services from other providers. So this is the view from a technology point of view. And just from an evolution point of view, I'm classifying it along the three broad lines: identity layer, payments layer, and data layer. Aadhaar, like I described, a unique identity card, eKYC, which helps you to provide the know your customer validations required while availing financial services, but on an electronic method. E-sign, electronic signature. The IMPS is the immediate payment services. APB is an Aadhaar payment bridge, so where the cash transfers. Essentially, the Aadhaar was conceptualized in last decade. In order, the main objective when it was conceptualized was to reduce the wastage of subsidies that are being provided across many areas. Even now, we have around more than 20% of the population below the poverty line. So these below poverty line or from many of the growing industries are provided a lot of subsidies. And Aadhaar was identified or brought in as a way to identify and check in, stop those subsidy breaches. So Aadhaar payment bridge and then Aadhaar enabled payment system, it's a biometric. So my biometrics are captured while I have taken the Aadhaar card. So I'm using my thumb impression, validating my presence and getting a payment or making a payment. Then unified payment interface, which has revolutionized the way we make the financial transactions. We may make payments or we receive payments over just a mobile app without even recalling the mobile, my account number or which branch I have my account, bank account. And incidentally, the UPI, which has been so successful, which processes around 1 billion payments a month, more than 1 billion payments a month, has decided to go international. And this unique facility, this wonderful infrastructure will be further rolled out to other countries now. DigiLocker, where I can securely store my government issued documents, my school cert, college certificates, then a consent artifact to provide digital consent in a secure manner. And the last one to came on block into the India stack is the account aggregator, which is what now I'm going to focus on. So what is an account aggregator? Before that, let's understand what is the DEPA, or Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture. So Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture was brought in to ensure a safe handover of my financial data. It deals with the individuals or the small and medium enterprises. So an organization or an individual's financial data in a secure manner with my consent to another financial institution in order to avail further services. So broadly, right now, there are four types of financial institutions which has been brought on board, onboarded. They are banks, the mutual funds, insurance and pension fund providers, and then the tax or GST platform. So how does it enables? It has three new set of stakeholders are being brought into the picture. One is the financial information providers, refers to the banks or the institutions where I have my accounts, my deposits, or my loans. Then financial information users, any entity where I am now trying to avail a new financial service and who wants to access my past credit history, my past transaction data, how much is my cash flow. Then account aggregator are the new set of entities which have come, which are coming into picture now, who will collect the data from financial information providers in a secured, masked manner, and then will pass on to the financial information users. So here at no point the whole DEPA architecture has been built in such a way that it's all are in a pre-built standardized APIs, and in no way at no time account aggregator as an entity has access to my data. It can only be accessed by two set of organizations, either it's a financial information providers and the financial information users. But the beauty of this regulation and the architecture is that it is built on the assumption of reciprocity, and there is no compulsion from a regulator's point of view for any bank to comply with it. It's for the bank to lose the market, to lose their customers by not joining this one. So at the end of the major goal of all this account aggregator ecosystem being created was to emerge or to bring forward the country as the world's first data democracy. While the countries are moving towards open banking or open finance or open data, we are talking about democratizing the data, giving the power of one's own data to the individual or the organization, and to enable him or her to make the best out of their data. It has six principles. One is open. There are not many restrictions for anybody to join and avail these services. Revocable. Any consent I give to Bank B to access my bank account details or cash flow details from Bank B, A, it can be revoked by me at any point of time. Granular. I can share either of my only account details or a profile details from a KYC perspective, or else my monthly savings balance, or else on a daily basis cash in and out flow. Then auditable, mandate, regulatory mandated, built into the architecture itself, need to have a fully built-in audit trail. Provide notice as and when an my new bank from where I just avail the loan by sharing my details accesses my data on a periodic basis, I do get a notification. I am being told that they are still accessing my data, and I have provided, assume I have provided for 12 months, I'll get the notification till then. Security by design. It has the architecture, the API designs have been taken into consideration, considering the utmost security aspects in place. Moving on, what are those problems that a DEPA or a account aggregator ecosystem is trying to solve? There are multiple. One is removing the paper-based processes. Now to avail a loan, to take a mortgage, I don't have to submit 3 months of banks, 3 years or 2 years of bank statements. Informal economy. India is still, a large part of the Indian economy is still on an informal way. There are a lot of unregistered micro or small or medium enterprises which thrives, which runs the economy. Then lack of touch points. I am a micro entrepreneur and I don't know who is that right guy to approach to avail the loan. Or high interest rate. Then because high interest rate, because banks do still consider, even if I am giving a collateral, bank might still categorize me as my collateral as not worthy at that much. Then there is the lending is predominantly driven by, or underwriting is driven by a balance sheet or asset based. Then the country thrives on the physical currency or in lack of low or non-existing credit history. So all these are the major problems which are getting addressed via this. So at a high level, what are the benefits for these different set of stakeholders? For the financial institutions, remove the intermediaries, do the processing faster, reduce the paperwork. So the reducing the paperwork means you don't have to send in a physical anybody to physically, or you don't need to maintain a branch to collect the documentation. And once you have the data, you can build or provide innovative value-added services on top of it. And definitely getting bringing in these extending these services or features to other industries. And as an individual, I can avail it faster. I don't need to run around to take the printouts of my bank statements. I don't need to worry which is that agent or where is his office. Rather, I can avail it over an app or a web application. And then my data is being shared, and then there will be financial institutions who will bring in some innovative products to address my problems, better interest rates for me. And if I'm an SME, I do get access to formal credit because I do have records of, say, past 3 years of formal cash flow based on my business. But what I lack, I don't have a credit history because I never availed a loan. Now, this helps me to bring into that formal credit sector, credit score based lending, or else my bank can themselves come up with an alternative credit algorithm and provide me. So since I'm providing my details, I'll be able to get better interest rate than I earlier used to avail. So we'll just show you an example of how the how it works from a loan or a mortgage perspective. So I'm approaching, I as an individual or an SME has accounts with bank B, C, and D, and I do make my tax payments on a regular basis, and the records are available with the Goods and Services Tax portal and the entity. So I have gone to bank A to avail loan. Bank A will request for these details, and I will take the services of an account aggregator whose app I will be using, and it will request the bank B and C and D to provide all these details. It will get consolidated at the account aggregator level and get passed on to the bank A. And I get bank A will process those data and will be giving me the loan. So if you have built, and if you are building such a very good account aggregator ecosystem or a infrastructure in place, why can't we extend it further? What are those value-added services, not only for in the financial sector, but also in any other industrial sector, that can be built while bringing in these ecosystem partners, these India Stack tools, and digitize the economy or make the economy a cashless? So the attempt, one of the two attempts that I, one of the two of those examples that I want to cite are, one of these is Open Credit Enablement Network, called as OCEN, which is essentially trying to standardize their language, standardize the way the lenders and the marketplaces work, and to bring in more transparency and bring in more options to the borrowers in the loan marketplace. And the next industry which is going to get positively changed by leveraging the India Stack is the health sector. This is still work in progress, platform called National Health Stack, which leverages both the private and public infrastructures. Like you can see on the top of the screen is a private innovation where the healthcare platforms, healthcare providers, or the healthcare payers will be bringing in their own platforms, and then other industry players like the pharmacies, hospitals, and all will be providing services. And the digital public good infrastructure part comes into the bottom, the middle layer, that is the protocol server or a matching engine, and the different types of registries, and a way to share my personal health records, and providing electronic claims. And all these are enabled by India Stack and something what we call as JAM, what is that is Jandhan, Aadhaar, and mobile. So along with the India Stack, what the government has done, what government did in the past couple of years, was one account has been identified as the predominant account for an individual, which has been linked to a unique mobile number, and these two are linked with that unique Aadhaar number of mine. So that forms the JAM, so which will ensure the any sort of outflow or inflow of the payments related, which will be leveraged as part of this National Health Stack. So I have included some of the key links to the many of the data sources or the information sources for you to read and understand any of these things more. I do have a couple of minutes more to go. In case you have any questions, I'm good to take that. So my contact details are also included in the last slide.
Thank you so much, Prashant. And it was really insightful, the overall session, and that's why we already have a couple of questions from the audience as well. So okay, we'll quickly take some of them. So we have a couple from Sriram Narayan, and one of his question is there any solid alternative to Aadhaar eKYC based solution well established in India?
Sorry, can you come again, Dheeraj?
So the question he asked is there any solid alternative to Aadhaar eKYC based solution well established in India?
It's not a alternative. There are no alternatives as such, because increasingly the banks, the financial institutions are adopting Aadhaar as the predominant eKYC based solution. It's only getting supplemented or further strengthened by using other tools and mechanisms. That's it. But that is going to be the eKYC mechanism for India to go forward.
Got it. And the next question he asked is, are there licensed account aggregators, assigned entities who have started offering API services in the market? If not, what is the perceived timeline?
So there are entities.
Right. And
one second, I'll just. So this box, there are entities which has been provided license who have come up with their own mobile app or web interfaces for these. But a formal launch of it is yet to take place, which was scheduled to take place in June, which has got postponed till September or October. But the beta run is ongoing. But the infrastructure and the initial set of license holders are all ready and in place.
Got it.
Yeah, I hope it addresses.
And the next one.
Is it regulatory binding that banks or FIs have to mandatorily share data to FAA? No, Sriram, it's not regulatory binding. The beauty of it is built on the principle of reciprocity, but it's for a bank or FI to lose their customer of maybe 50 year or history of with them, but it's for them to lose their that customer by not providing these services. If you are not providing the service, if you are not providing the data to account aggregator, you cannot access the account details of any other customer. Are there any verified credit data sources we can tap on? Yes, there are. All the major credit bureaus are operating in India and do provide services to the financial institutions, many fintechs. And also there are new age fintechs who have come up with alternative model of credit scoring also. So credit data sources are not at all a problem.
Right. So for example, CIBIL is one of them, right?
Yes, CIBIL, TransUnion, Experian, everybody is present, and there are entities who have built in alternate credit modeling to tap the bottom of the pyramid, the different ways of leveraging the data and coming up with a credit score. And we hope actually the intention or the one of the goals of this account aggregator ecosystem is to bring up new ways of credit scoring to fold those bottom of the pyramid people or the organizations and provide access to them. Just to add, actually only 11% of MSMEs are micro, small and medium enterprises in India have access to formal credit, only 11%. So that gives you the vast opportunity available at the bottom of the pyramid, or rather the bottom of the pyramid seems to have the access and the rest of the pyramid doesn't have. 11 to 89.
Right, yeah.
How about data security, which is shared across various platforms? Though I haven't shared much details on the DEPA, the data empowerment and protection architecture, the links are there available in my deck. You can have a look at it. There are inbuilt data security measurements, and the account aggregator at no point can access the data. All the data are masked and secure. They are just taking the data, it's just a pipe. They have just built a pipe to give it from one point to another, and they have no access to the real data. And another aspect which I forgot to mention was only a couple of regulators like the banking regulator, insurance, pension funds are only providing access to this. So I cannot go and become a financial information provider or an user. Or rather both, as long as I am not registered or approved by one of these regulators. So, and that is one of the grievances of the fintechs in India who have spread far and wide and who have got a good customer base built, because they are not formally registered with any of these regulators, and they have restrictions in terms of accessing this account aggregator ecosystem.
Right. Yeah.
Because their whole infrastructure is built on top of a bank or another insurance company's stack, and they themselves don't provide the services. It's only that layer that they have built and built the customer base.
Correct. Yeah. And thanks a lot, Prashant, for answering all the questions.